Man is a conceptual being who gains and uses knowledge, again, only by a volitional choice, a volitional cognitive effort. And it is because one must exercise his volitional faculty, make a specific effort of will to initiate and sustain a process of thought, that many don't do it. They apparently find the effort involved too much or not to their liking. The approach of most bodybuilders to training from the start amounts to little more than a blind leap into the dark. Throughout life, we all encounter innumerable theories on every subject, from religion to philosophy, to politics, to the healing arts, and of course, bodybuilding exercise. And because so few in our culture were taught to think rationally and to judge critically, most are left disconcertingly confused when confronted with the necessity of making an intellectual choice, such as which training theory to employ. In fact, I realized that I was like this when I reached my late teens. Most symptomatic was my notion that if something was printed, it obviously had to be true. I learned later, of course, that my notion was illogical, as not everything that's printed could possibly be true, since so many notions, ideas conflict with other ideas. It was Arthur Jones who divested me of that bit of ragtag illogic when he barked, "Mike, just because something is printed doesn't mean it has to be true. In fact, 90% of what is printed on all subjects is outright hogwash." And now, some 25 years later, a lot of experience, study, and thinking later, I realize Arthur was being charitable. It's more like 98% of what is published on all subjects is garbage. As much as this seminar is about the human body and its improvement, it is also about the mind and its improvement. Why would a seminar on bodybuilding be about the human mind? Because obviously intelligence is what makes it possible to understand anything at all, including exercise science, and that which is of most interest to all of us here today, and that is us, the members of the species man, the divine spark in the great chain of being. It has been averred all too often that bodybuilders are dumb or stupid, which simply isn't true, as evidenced by the number of phone calls I receive from intelligent bodybuilders every day. These include people from all walks of life, such as medical doctors, lawyers, physicists, stockbrokers, students, people who also just happen to be bodybuilders. I will not talk down on the assumption that the audience so lacks intellectual depth that you are incapable of exercising the mental effort required to integrate knowledge of a higher order. Nor will I insult your intelligence by expecting you to accept anything I say simply because I've won a few bodybuilding contests. It is only on the basis of grasping the logic of an argument that one should agree. Nor will I bore you with the type of intellectual pablum you've read so often in some of the muscle magazines. In case you haven't noticed, the vast majority of articles written on the subject of training consist of little more than a series of arbitrary, biblical-like commandments. Thou shalt perform 5 sets of this exercise, and thou shalt perform 5 sets of that one. Why? Blank out. No reason, no logic ever provided. The realm of the intellect audience is more demanding than the average bodybuilder and writer recognizes, and that formulating a valid, non-contradictory theory of training requires knowledge of the nature of human physiology, as well as knowledge of the nature of man's mind and his method of using it, namely logic. A mere passionate discharge of the arbitrary contents of one's subconscious onto a piece of paper is just that, intellectual vomitus. As a man of reason, I seek to act only on the basis of understanding the reasons for doing something, as all mature adults should. And that, once again, is what this seminar is about, a reasoned, principled, logical approach to productive bodybuilding exercise, one that can be learned by anyone willing to exercise the required mental effort. Or as Arthur Jones used to say, just think a little bit more than none, you'd be surprised at the results. I presume, after all, you came to Seattle Center today because of your enthusiastic desire to be a successful bodybuilder or strength athlete, whether to actualize your potential for personal reasons or to be Mr. Washington State, world champion, or Mr. Olympia. And that you already understand that the basis of a rational approach to bodybuilding, or any other arena of human endeavor, is the recognition that only the specific appropriate knowledge can lead one to engage in the specific actions required to achieve a goal. The material in today's seminar, no, is not infinitely complex, but it's not intellectual pabulum either. Why not cast aside all other concerns for now, get intense mentally, focus on the logic of my ideas, and once and for all, clear up any and all confusion. Then you will be able to proceed with the greatest power possible to man, not muscular power, but the power of certainty. There does exist a viable intellectual discipline, exercise science. In the next section, I will explain the logically interdependent hierarchy of ideas that constitutes exercise science. Again, so that you may learn to think logically about the subject and go on confidently and successfully to achieve your bodybuilding goals. Before concluding, however, I'm going to address one important issue before concluding this introductory material and moving on to the theoretical material. I'd like to address one important issue that will serve as a direct prelude to the theory. And it has to do with the near universal confusion that exists with regard to the fact that there can only be one valid theory of productive bodybuilding exercise or anything else. This confusion is centrally responsible for most of the failures in bodybuilding, and I can tell you unequivocally without a doubt, having been a trainer for the past 10 years, dealing with up to 50 and 60 people a day on the phone and in person, more bodybuilders fail to achieve their goals than succeed. Most bodybuilders make the mistake of approaching the subject of training with the idea that all training theories have some merit or are of equal validity. Then they waste precious time frantically trying one after the other in the hope that somehow, someday, some way, they'll happen upon something that works. And as a result, very few bodybuilders achieve their goals. It could not possibly be true, audience, that all, or many, or even two training theories are of equal validity. Since a theory is a set of abstract principles which purports to be either a correct description of some aspect of reality and or a guide for successful human action, and there is only one reality, obviously, therefore there is and can be only one valid theory of any aspect of it. Just as there is only one valid theory of physics, electronics, chemistry, medicine, epistemology, relativity, evolution. Likewise, there is but one true theory, one valid theory of productive bodybuilding exercise, and it just so happens to be the theory of high intensity exercise. It has to be something, right? Well, this is what it is. It's not so difficult to grasp or understand. The science of exercise, like the science of medicine, is based on an understanding of the principles of human physiology. I emphasize the word human, meaning, of course, that these principles are universal, i.e. applicable to every member of the species. If everyone's cells, muscles, and organs were constituted and functioned differently, doctors couldn't make diagnoses, dispense medicines, or perform surgeries. It is this fact, the fact that the basic principles of human physiology are universal, that makes it possible for me to state with absolute certainty that there is only one valid theory of training, i.e. one best way to train. It is not my mere opinion that every human being requires intense training to stimulate growth. It is a well-authenticated fact beyond debate. And because the magnitude of the toll on the body's limited recovery ability made by high intensity training is so enormous, such training must be brief and infrequent to allow for the production of an increase. The major philosophic theme of this seminar is that without a firm intellectual grasp of and guidance by a valid theory, no one can be certain he is on the right course. A sane individual setting out on a trip from Los Angeles to New York would consult a map being a theory of how to get from one place to another. Without it, he would get lost, lose whatever certainty and motivation he had, and terminate his effort along the way. Knowledge, human knowledge, like any other value, has to be gained through a volitional effort, an act of choice. Anyone smart enough to learn the ABCs, write a sentence, or read a book with enough effort can make use of the knowledge he gains today. Recently, one of my phone consultation clients expressed considerable astonishment that he had been able to realize so much uninterrupted progress with heavy-duty, high-intensity training. And I explained to my client that such should not be a surprise, that there's no mystery to any of this, that people have been growing muscles beyond normal levels for at least 10,000 years, that we live in a knowable, rational universe of absolute clear-cut identity, guided by one set of immutable, never-changing principles, and that the cause and effect relationship between intense exercise and muscle growth has been understood for quite some time, even though the majority of self-styled experts in this field fail to grasp it. I concluded by pointing out to this individual that it is reality and its laws, the laws of nature, that dictate the causes which must be enacted to affect the buildup of muscle mass beyond normal levels, and that once these causes are clearly understood, the task of developing bigger and stronger muscles, in fact, while requiring high-intensity effort, is really quite simple. There's nothing so difficult about what's going on with all this in terms of how to build big muscles. It really is quite simple. Nature also dictates what mental causes must be enacted to affect an intellectual understanding on any subject or issue. One must first recognize that all human knowledge has a nature. Remember, we're talking about the laws of nature here, my favorite subject. You must recognize that all human knowledge has a nature or identity. All human knowledge, I repeat, all human knowledge is hierarchical in structure with a base of fundamental ideas or principles which must be first grasped before moving up the logical ladder or hierarchy to more complex derivative ideas. This may be most readily observed in mathematical knowledge or science, where the fundamentals, of course, are addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. It is only on the basis of first grasping these fundamental principles that one may then move to more complex derivative knowledge, such as algebra and calculus. Now, the major reason most bodybuilders remain confused is that they don't understand that the context of knowledge, which constitutes bodybuilding science, has a base of fundamental principles too, just like mathematics, and that these relate to the issues of intensity, volume, and frequency. In fact, I hear bodybuilders every day droning on and on, endlessly, asking questions that are something like the equivalent of algebra or calculus, while they have yet to grasp the 2 + 2 = 4 of bodybuilding. The following audience will help you gain that knowledge. Let's approach the subject of what makes muscles grow beyond normal levels as a good exercise scientist might. There aren't many of those around today, so you have to kind of create your own image of a good exercise scientist. Having observed innumerable bodybuilders and strength athletes work out, the good exercise scientist concludes that there must obviously be something about the workout itself, some element or variable which can be isolated and identified as responsible for causing muscle growth stimulation. How does he find it? Where does he launch his investigation aimed at discovering the variable, the element responsible for inducing growth stimulation? The most likely place to start is by looking at one of the more readily observed attributes of the facts in reality, of the things that exist in reality, namely quantity. In this context, the exercise scientist would concern himself with the volume or number of sets being performed. Now, since people who perform no weight training have muscles of normal size, and those who perform some resistance exercise usually do grow larger muscles, perhaps growth stimulation is directly related to the volume. It's not an illogical or irrational place to start an investigation. That's where I would look. That's where I looked. In order to test his hypothesis, He observes numerous individuals training over a period of time, during which the volume of the exercise grows progressively greater. But something is wrong. Beyond a definite point, increased volume resulted in a complete lack of progress, and any further increase in volume, the subjects inevitably, invariably, in every case, grew weaker and suffered overuse atrophy. So, what may have initially appeared obvious now is not so obvious. The growth stimulus cannot be directly related to the quantity of the exercise effort, or the training subjects would have experienced best results with the highest possible volume. While the notion that more is better is attractive in its simplicity, it just doesn't work. Let's look for a moment, in fact, at the implicit logic in that idea. More is better, audience, means literally that. More is better means more is better. There's a built-in guarantee. If 20 sets are good, i.e. yield satisfactory results, then 40 sets would be even better. And 80 better still, and 120 sets better still, and so on into infinity. And that's where we find ourselves. There it is, the obvious tenuity, the monumental absurdity of the volume argument, all wrapped up in a singular childlike notion that more is better. It is erroneous, illogical, non-productive, and even counterproductive. Look about you. Everyone who engages in exercise or athletic training of any sorts performs a certain volume of work. If volume was the key in and of itself, the stimulus responsible for triggering growth, those who perform the most exercise, the greatest volume, such as marathon runners, would have the largest muscles. It's also interesting and illuminating to note here that the majority who advocate the volume approach have little or nothing to say, at least not consistently as part of a valid non-contradictory theory, about what the actual stimulus is responsible for triggering the body's growth mechanism into motion. At least I'm not aware of it, or any of you. What do the volume people claim is the stimulus? I guess implicitly it's the volume, but they never give you any explanation as to why that is or what the mechanism is. And that's one of the reasons I refer to theirs as the blind, non-theoretical volume approach. It's literally blind. Yes, anyone and everyone who exercises, aerobically, anaerobically, or athletically, has to perform some volume of exercise, but it may be any volume. Parenthetically here, later I will logically demonstrate that the issue of volume in high-intensity anaerobic weight resistance exercise is a negative factor, period. The vast majority who exercise typically do so for 1 hour. If you were to go and do a survey throughout the gyms in the world, you would find that the average trainee trains for an hour. Why? Because it's a traditional or cultural convenience. We get paid by the hour. We go to the psychiatrist by the hour. Therefore, it's only logical, right? Train for an hour. Of course, I'm being facetious. Yes, the vast majority train for an hour. Yet such doesn't invariably result in the same or similar or any muscle increase. So, where do we now turn to discover the variable in exercise responsible for stimulating growth? Since it is not the quantity or volume of effort, there is but one place left to go, the quality or intensity of the effort. The best way to explain a highly abstract principle like intensity is to go to a concrete example in perceptual reality. Let's assume hypothetically that every one of you here today is capable of curling a 100-pound barbell for a maximum of 10 reps to failure. Obviously, audience, the first rep of that set would be the easiest. Or to be more technically precise, we would say the first rep requires the least intensity of effort. The first rep does fatigue you a little bit, however. That's why the second rep is always a little bit harder. Whereas the first rep may require on the order of 8 or 10% intensity of effort, the second rep, you see, may require 15 or 20% intensity of effort. The second rep fatigues you even further, of course, and that's why the third rep is harder still. requiring a more intense effort than did the second. Without belaboring the issue, you know that's how it goes with each successive rep of the set. Each one becomes harder to complete, requiring a more intense effort than did the preceding. Until finally we get to the last possible rep in this hypothetical case, again, a set of barbell curls to failure at 10 reps with 100 pounds. The last rep would be the only one where we say it requires literally 100% intensity of effort. You're gritting your teeth, you're shaking all over, and you barely get the bar to the top. Now I ask you, which repetition of that set is more likely to stimulate an increase in strength and muscular size? The first rep, which is the least intense, or the last rep, the hardest one, the only rep requiring 100% intensity of effort? Of course, the last one. I have had some people say the first. They were just nervous and just lost their focus entirely. Another question. If you were actually able to curl a 100-pound barbell for a maximum of 10 reps to failure, now you would never do this, but again, hypothetically here, and for some weird reason you put the bar right back down at that point, never attempting a second, third, fourth, or fifth rep and so on, would you ever grow? No. Because the intensity of the stress on the body's physiology would not be sufficiently threatening to warrant an adaptive response. In this case, a strength and size increase, just like you would never obtain a suntan no matter how long you sat in front of a 100-watt light bulb rubbing Phosmogain suntan lotion all over you. Nature requires fundamentally, first of all, the presence of a high-intensity sunlight stress. Only then does the suntan lotion issue become important. Executing that last, almost impossible rep causes the body to dip into what's called its reserve ability. And since your body only has a small amount of reserve to draw upon before depletion occurs, the body protects itself from future assaults on its reserves by enlarging upon its existing ability through the compensatory buildup of more muscle mass. Only high-intensity training can force the body to resort to its reserve ability sufficiently to stimulate an adaptive response in the form of a muscle mass increase. Repeating tasks that are well within your existing capacity do absolutely nothing to stimulate growth. Ending a set before failure just because an arbitrary number of reps have been completed will do nothing to stimulate an increase or induce growth. Carrying a set to a point where you are forced to utilize 100% of your momentary muscular ability is the single most important factor for increasing strength and size. Working to a point of momentary muscular failure where another rep is impossible despite your greatest effort ensures that you pass through the breakover point or that point in the set below which growth is not stimulated and above which you growth is stimulated. Even the detractors of high intensity training theory would be forced to admit that the last rep of a set to failure is more productive than the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and so on. Thus, without realizing it, they have embraced the first principle of the theory. Although in denying any validity to high-intensity training theory at all, as they do, of course they are denying the entire theory, including the principle of intensity, which is tantamount to saying that the first rep of a set is just as likely to stimulate growth as is the last. But then what would you expect from the mystics of muscle? A few individuals have raised the intelligent question as to whether it is actually necessary to train to failure where 100% intensity of effort is required to complete the last rep. For instance, maybe only 67, 85, or 92% intensity of effort is all that's required to stimulate an increase. The problem here, however, is one in measuring intensity. There are only two possible accurate measures of intensity, 0% when you're completely at rest, and 100% when you're exerting yourself maximally. So, as long as you are exerting yourself with 100% intensity of effort, the point is, you have passed through every possible breakover point and growth will be stimulated. Man's specific physiologic characteristics dictate what training causes must be enacted to achieve the desired effect. The primary causal determinant obviously is, unequivocally, without a doubt, the imposition of a high-intensity training stress. And while the imposition of a high-intensity training stress is a first necessary cause, it is not sufficient cause to effect an optimal increase. There is a very important physiological characteristic which must be considered, one that has been perpetually ignored by the bodybuilding orthodoxy, exercise science, and perhaps by you, which is why many of you fail to achieve your strength training and bodybuilding goals. Those who are unaware of the nature, role, and value of philosophic fundamental principles usually have a very difficult time achieving their goals. Being emotionally driven instead of conceptually directed, they seem to operate on the fuzzy notion that if their mere desire to build big muscles is great, such will suffice. And never having made it a policy to check for inappropriate mental habits, they semi-consciously resort to the unchecked, unchallenged premise, more is better. If stated in words, their basic attitude would be, in effect, I want big muscles so badly. If I persevere and go to the gym for hours every day, eventually I will succeed. After all, everything I've heard in the culture suggests that if I'm relentless, if I'm a slave to my art, through sheer dint of unrelenting effort, I must succeed. Well, audience, the joke is on them, how pathetically wrong they are. As I indicated earlier, it is the laws of nature, literally, that dictate the specific causes that must be enacted to achieve a goal. Neither a wish, a whim, a hope, a dream, or a desire is sufficient to cause a muscle mass increase. Neither is the application of a false idea or theory blindly accepted. I made the point a moment ago that man's physiologic nature demands the imposition of a high-intensity training stress as a first necessary cause, but that it is not sufficient cause to affect the desired result. One of man's specific physiologic characteristics dictates that the training stress must be cautiously regulated in terms of both volume and frequency. It is his strictly limited recovery ability. The human being does not possess an infinite capacity for tolerating the exhaustive effects of intense physical stresses. In fact, nothing in the universe is literally infinite. And there have been people who have either implied, suggested, or stated explicitly over the years that there is no such thing as overtraining, that man's recovery ability is infinite. And as I just stated a moment ago, nothing in the universe, including the universe itself, is literally infinite. This fact is what led Arthur Jones to state, and I quote, "It is only rational to use that which exists in limited supply as economically as possible," close quote. Few would argue that a high-intensity training stress is an absolute requirement for stimulating growth. The problem most people have in fully accepting the theory results from their failure to adequately grasp the significance of the ideas just stated with regard to recovery ability. While the principle of intensity must be understood as the first requisite for understanding anything else of value about exercise, the fact of a limited recovery ability is the next key concept that must be grasped in the logically interdependent hierarchy of scientific knowledge and exercise. It is only on the basis of knowing that the body has a limited recovery ability that one may understand why the volume and frequency must be cautiously, even hyper-cautiously, regulated. I realize now today that the issue of recovery ability has never gained the full attention it deserves, which is why so many continue to chronically, grossly overtrain, and for that precise reason fail to achieve their goals. When was the last time you saw the term recovery ability used by the bodybuilding orthodoxy, the exercise science establishment? As I mentioned earlier, they perpetually ignore and evade the issue, pretending it doesn't even exist. When in fact, again, once you've grasped the principle of intensity, the issue of a limited recovery ability becomes the next most important issue in exercise science. As I've stated repeatedly in my books and articles, not only do these people fail to define any of their concepts, but their conceptual range is profoundly limited, which is a euphemistic way of saying these are stupid people. That sounds much better, doesn't it? Their conceptual range is profoundly limited. I used to use the word terms like stupid and dumb all the time, and then I realized I never saw that kind of thing in Ayn Rand's writing. She would say they are self-arrested or concrete-bound. It's a nice philosophical way of saying they're dummies. And it is a lot better, less harsh way of referring to people. The fact that recovery ability is strictly limited leads to a logically warranted conclusion. And this is perhaps the most important thing that I can get across today. In fact, when Arthur Jones told me this years ago, this statement struck me instantly as remarkably intelligent, very important. After considering some of the deeper implications over a few days, I got so damned excited you couldn't peel me off the ceiling for a week. I had no doubt that this was the key. Once you understand intensity, this is the key to understanding exercise science and the key to the perfect, proper, appropriate application necessary for unbreached spectacular progress. The issue of volume or number of sets, whether you do one set or 100 sets, insofar that you train at all, do any sets, even one set, the issue of volume is a negative factor, negative with a capital N. In other words, to the extent to which you work out, perform a number of sets. Volume is a negative because for every set performed, there is caused a deeper inroad into recovery ability. For every set performed, more and more of the body's limited reserve of resources is used in the attempt to recover or compensate for the merely exhaustive effects of the workout, leaving that much less left over or available for overcompensation in the form of muscle growth. Now, in order to better understand the concept inroad, merely visualize it as the term clearly suggests, an in into the road or a hole being dug. You perform one set, you dig a small hole. You do a second set, you dig a deeper hole. A third set, it goes deeper still, and so on. This audience is a negative factor, literally. I'm not speaking metaphorically or trying to make some kind of weird analogy. Volume is a negative because for every set you do, the deeper that hole gets, then that much more of your body's resources will be used, or you could say wasted, in recovery, overcoming the deficit, the inroad, filling the hole, leaving that much less left over for building the mountain on top of the muscle. But of course, you have to do at least one set to have a workout. Remember how I started this. I said the issue of volume is a negative factor, period. Even one set represents a negative influence here. Insofar that you do any sets at all, you make an inroad. And the greater that inroad, more and more and more of your body's resources are wasted on filling the hole, recovery, overcoming the deficit, leaving that much less left over for building the mountain on top, overcompensating in the form of muscle growth. Ideally, one could stimulate growth with zero sets. That way, none of the body's resources would be wasted on recovery. Your recovery ability would be used entirely for overcompensation for building the mountain on top, and you'd grow so damn fast it would stagger the imagination. You see now how important the issue of recovery ability is. It should be one of the two issues of most central concern to exercise science. And as I said before, they all but completely evade the subject. In a recent issue of Flex magazine, one of Weider's top champs claimed to perform from 35 to 45 sets total per workout, which of course amounts to gross overtraining, helped by the mitigating influence of recovery ability enhancing drugs like steroids and growth hormone. Considering this, I find it interesting that the exercise science establishment is now advocating that all bodybuilders, including the natural non-steroid ones, do 60 sets of workout every day. On occasion, I've had a phone client or one of the members of the audience at a seminar ask, Mike, you make such a big deal about doing just one set. You make it sound like black and white, that the fate of the world hinges on this. Mike, would it really make a difference if I did a second set? Would it be a mistake? And I realized not all that long ago that, in fact, going from one set to two sets is the biggest mistake you could possibly make. It's not just a mistake, it's the biggest mistake possible. Because going from one set to two sets is not merely a linear or sequential increase of one unit. It represents a 100% increase in the volume of the exercise. You just doubled the exercise, and therefore you doubled the inroad into recovery ability. So even if there was some advantage in terms of achieving a greater growth stimulus by doing a second set, it would be completely nullified by the fact that you increased the volume that much and made a greater inroad into recovery ability. Does that make sense? The single major cause of lack of meaningful progress in this area is overtraining. And if you think I'm overstating it, or that I mention the issue too often in my articles, you are wrong. Considering that it is the major cause of lack of progress, because it is the reason most bodybuilders fail to achieve their goals, and because the orthodoxy, along with exercise science, unconscionably continue to evade the point, I'm actually understating it. Bodybuilding is not dying because of drug use, but because Weider and the powers that be promulgate the notion that volume training is the best way to proceed, while not informing you that their champs are taking outrageous quantities of drugs to help counteract overtraining. I find it curious that the great majority of bodybuilders, knowing that overtraining means something decidedly negative, never look into the issue seriously. Think back over your own training careers. The topic, the subject of overtraining was being mentioned all the time, but no one ever took it seriously. It was just kind of glossed over as something kind of sort of negative, something less than desirable, but who in the hell knows what to do about it? The term overtraining is always used as a negative. In fact, try to use the concept in a positive context and you quickly realize it's impossible. Try to think about, make a statement regarding overtraining that's a positive. You can't do it. By definition, overtraining means performing any more exercise in terms of both volume and frequency than is precisely required to stimulate growth. The majority of bodybuilders today still seem to operate on the notion that their purpose is to go into the gym to see how many sets they can do, how much they can take, or how long they can mindlessly endure. And that is wrong because bodybuilding is not aerobic. A bodybuilding workout, in other words, audience, is not an endurance contest. Bear in mind that your purpose is not to go into the gym to see how long you can mindlessly endure. Your purpose as a bodybuilder or strength athlete is to go into the gym and intelligently, logically, rationally do what nature requires to trigger the body's growth mechanism into motion and no more. Then get the hell out of the gym, go home, rest, and grow. That sounds real good, doesn't it? Gets my attention every time I say it. Many bodybuilders apparently don't understand that the big picture in bodybuilding is comprised essentially of two elements of equal value, literally 50-50, not 60-40 or 70-30, but 50-50, with either of the elements being even slightly more important than the other. The first element, of course, there's no gainsaying it, is the actual workout itself. And the second element, the other 50%, just as important, is the rest period between workouts. And here's why. The workout, you must understand, audience, doesn't actually produce muscular growth. Remember, the workout is a stimulus. The workout merely stimulates the body's growth mechanism into motion. It is the body itself that produces the growth, but only if left undisturbed by further exercise stress during a sufficient rest period. Or in other words, if you don't rest enough, you won't grow enough, if at all. Now here's the crux of the problem. How could anyone know with reasonable certainty how much time need elapse between workouts? Well, I'm going to tell you. Immediately upon completion of a workout, you don't feel the same as you did before the workout, do you? No, you're exhausted. In addition to the personal experience or the subjective sense of feeling fatigued, you're also exhausted in the technical sense, in that a considerable portion of your body's resources or recovery ability was used to fuel the workout. You feel like you're in a hole. There was a deficit created. In fact, recall from earlier that to the extent that one works out, that is, performs a number of sets, he digs a hole into his recovery ability. The first thing that the body must do after the workout is not build the mountain on top of the muscle, but fill the hole, or recovery, we call it. And the crucial point here is the process of recovery is not completed zippo immediately upon completion of the workout. In fact, the completion of the recovery process itself may take up to 5 days or even longer in some cases, before the body even has a chance to start building the mountain on top of the muscle. And if you train again before the recovery process is completed, you will short-circuit the growth production process entirely. That's correct. The recovery process alone may take up to several days itself to be completed before the body has a chance to even start building the muscle. And here's the proof. Every bodybuilder of experience has had the experience of performing, let's say, a tremendous leg workout on a Friday afternoon. He breaks all of his personal records. His reps are up. Then he intentionally rests all weekend, thinking he'll wake up Monday feeling totally refreshed and recovered. But to his surprise, he wakes up Monday feeling a sense of generalized or systemic fatigue. One of the chief sources of confusion on the issue of frequency is that bodybuilders don't realize that exercise, in addition to having a localized effect on the muscle being worked, also has a systemic effect. Remember, you have to rest long enough between workouts, not just for localized recovery, which actually takes place fairly quickly, even within less than hours. You must also allow enough time between workouts to allow for systemic recovery, which can take weeks, depending upon the type of training you're engaged in. Audience, if you now recognize that the rest between workouts is just as important as the workout itself, do you see where it stands to reason that there must be a perfect or optimum number of days of rest? I have learned through vast experience as a trainer that for most people, training once every 7 to 21 days is literally almost miraculous compared to any other frequency. It's been a long day throughout which you've been inundated by an enormous amount of abstract theoretical knowledge, which can grow tedious after a while. In fact, which after a definite point makes it increasingly difficult to stay up or to remain motivated. I'm going to finish up here today, not with any more abstract theory, but a concretization of the theory, the nuts and bolts, the actual training program itself. What I'm going to present to you is a detailed outline of a modified, improved version of the consolidation program listed in Heavy Duty 2, Mind and Body, my latest book. From one perspective, at least, it might be said that this is a perfect bodybuilding program if you keep in mind, at least, that the ideal situation is to be able to stimulate all of the major muscles of the body with the least amount of exercise possible. We'll go through this quickly without unduly hurrying it. What I would suggest you consider trying, at least for part of the year, of course, you're not morally, legally bound to do this all year round, but as I tell my training clients, having hired me as your trainer, it's my job to get you growing stronger and bigger in the fastest way possible. And I have found through considerable experience that this program literally does represent, again, from a certain perspective, throughout part of the training year, a perfect program I would suggest you start by training once a week, doing two different basic workouts. We'll refer to them here as workout A and workout B. Now, a lot of people like conveniently to work out on weekends, so what you would do is on the first weekend, do workout A. 7 days later, do workout B. Workout A will consist of, number one, a set of squats, preferably on a machine. If not the Nautilus Duo squat, then perhaps a Smith machine. If you have any problems with your back or you can't do squats for whatever reason, then I would suggest you substitute leg presses. Do one set of squats to failure, 8 to 15 reps. Now, that's just a guide figure, by the way, 8 to 15. I don't know that there is a perfect rep range, but you got to start somewhere. You have to do something. 8 to 15 has proven empirically through observation to work quite well for the legs. After a brief rest, and by a brief rest, I mean go get a drink of water, walk around for a few seconds, 30 seconds, a minute, depending upon your existing condition, but rest as little as possible. As soon as you recognize you're ready to go, proceed to a set of close grip, palms up, pull downs. Close grip, palms up, pull downs. And by that I mean your grip should be 8 or 10 inches apart depending upon your shoulder width and your physical stature. Palms up, I mean a curling grip. Your palms are literally facing up. Initiate the movement with extreme deliberation, utilizing no thrust or momentum to get the weight started and to keep it moving. Pull it down to your clavicles under hyper strict control. Pause for a long static count of 2 or 3 seconds and lower under strict control. That's all you're going to do, a set of squats, 8 to 15 to failure, followed by a very brief rest, and a set of close grip, palms up, pull down, 6 to 10 reps to failure. That's all you're going to do. Two sets, two exercises, one set of each. 1 week later, you'll do workout B, which will consist of, number one, a set of regular, not stiff-legged, but the regular old-fashioned deadlift, or as many of you here seem to enjoy, you might want to use the trap bar. That's fine with me. 5 to 8 reps to failure. After a brief rest, proceed to exercise number two, a set of dips, 6 to 10 reps to failure. Now, don't make the mistake of gauging or evaluating the success of any one of these workouts based on pump or soreness. If getting a pump was clear proof that growth was stimulated, then all these people I see training volume style for hours, even 2 and 3 times a day, would have 32-inch arms by now because they get pumped every day, twice and thrice a day for years. Getting a pump is not important. It feels good. I like it myself, but it's not important. The main point here is, and this is an important point, you won't know that any one of these workouts was a successful workout until the next time you do that workout. If you're stronger, obviously a positive change took place. And the point there is keep a training journal. Record the date of each workout. List your body weight at the beginning. List the exercises, the amount of weight, of course, and be real cautious and careful about this last point. Accurately record the number of reps. Okay? Thank you.